Ghee versus butter. What is ghee anyway, and why do some people take it for their skin vitamins? Now, ghee can be a little bit expensive to buy, so at the end of this video, I'm going to give you a recipe so you can make it at home with just one ingredient. Let's dive in. You see, today, I'm not just talking about any ordinary fat here, not just vitamin E, but butter is often listed as a great source of vitamin K2, that vitamin that places the calcium into your bones, yes, your face bone too, as opposed to into your heart and brain vessels where it can cause a heart attack or stroke. And then there's vitamin A, you know, the vitamin A from retinols, that's how you'd most likely know it. The A-lister of ingredients for your skin and to smooth it out. In fact, we're told that these are some of the best sources of K2 for your bone and heart health, meaning butter and ghee. But is that true? Today, let's fact check that. So ghee is clarified butter, which means it's butter with the water and milk solids removed. Compared to butter, ghee contains more fat, but contains no lactose. Yes, I said no lactose. How many of you are lactose intolerant? I'll also talk about the smoke point because I started cooking my steaks with ghee, and I'll tell you why. Here's a picture from my steak in ghee a couple nights ago. You can see there is no white churn at the top like you get with butter. Butter's made from cream that has been separated from milk, then churned in to become butter. Here's a picture of melted butter before it's made into ghee. You see the white stuff at the top? So you're probably thinking now, well, if ghee has less, why does it cost more? That's a great question. Sometimes things we buy that have less, in fact, cost more. And that's why I'll give you a recipe at the end, so it's less expensive. In any case, it's been used in Indian and Pakistani cultures for thousands of years. The term comes from the Sanskrit word meaning sprinkled. Ghee was created to prevent butter from spoiling during warm weather. In addition to cooking, it's used in the Indian alternative medicine system, Ayurveda, in which it's known as Ghrita. Because its milk solids have been removed, ghee does not require refrigeration and can be kept at room temperature for several weeks. In fact, like coconut oil, it's a solid when kept at room temperatures. In fact, it's very similar to the consistency of coconut oil at room temperature. So how does it compare with butter nutritionally? Let's look at the nutritional content. If we take one tablespoon, think 15 grams of ghee versus butter. In terms of calories, ghee has 123 calories in this tablespoon, whereas butter only has 100. If we look at fat, again, ghee has more fat at 14 grams versus 11 grams for butter. Saturated fat, ghee has more, again, 9 grams versus 7 grams for butter. Monounsaturated fat, 4 grams for ghee and 3 grams for butter. Polyunsaturated fat, they're about the same with 0.5 grams each. Protein, both only have a trace amount. What about carbohydrates? Both only have a trace of carbs. Here we go. Let's look at the vitamins. If we look at vitamin A, ghee has 13% of the daily value, whereas butter only has 11%. Vitamin E, 3% for ghee, 2% for butter. And here's the one I want to point out to you, vitamin K, 1% of the daily value for both butter and ghee. So let's stop and dissect this for a moment. You see, vitamin K2 is good for your heart and bone health. Many of us take it in a supplement because it takes calcium from the arteries and fortifies the bone with it, creating strong bones instead of hard arteries. But there isn't enough vitamin K in a healthy daily intake of ghee to substantiate that claim that it's a food rich in K2. If you take a vitamin K2 D3 supplement, we get 100 micrograms of vitamin K2, you see here on the label. And of course, you get 5,000 international units, or what we call 125 micrograms of D3 with it. So no, you don't want the half a cup of ghee that it would take to get your daily K2 amount. Your fat intake would be just too high. But ghee is a healthy fat to cook with, and vitamin K is fat soluble. Using ghee to cook vitamin K-rich foods like kale, broccoli, spinach, now this will help you get the vitamin K you need with a healthy fat for long-term heart and bone health. And using butter and ghee will help you to avoid using seed oils. Watch my video. I'll put up here on seed oils. I'll link it up at the end as well. What do you want to do to ramp up your vitamin K2 if you don't want to take a supplement, or even if you are taking a supplement and want K2 rich foods like I do? Think natto, cheese, sauerkraut, and that's fermented too. Beef liver has it, and also eel, but I don't eat, I do eat eel and sushi, but not enough to say that's where I'm getting my K2. Now we may as well talk other vitamins for skin while we're here. You see, ghee can help ramp up your intake of vitamin A, a fat-soluble vitamin that's important for maintaining eye health, skin health, and immune function. You guys know vitamin A from retinols. Retinol's a vitamin A derivative, and of course, plasma restore gummies that support face fat. For skincare, I prefer retinaldehydes to retinols or retinoics. I put a retinaldehyde and a retinol together in my retinol A cream. And for those that don't want to take supplements for vitamin A and you want to eat or take it into your diet, which is great, think liver again, sweet potatoes, carrots, leafy greens, of course, pumpkin, butternut, squash, cod liver oil. Some of you I know do take it, and eggs. Ghee is also rich in omega-3 fatty acids, and they help support decreased inflammation and protect against heart disease. I know many of you are on omega-3s and you supplement with it as well. Now, back to the comparison. Both ghee and butter contain nearly 100% of their calories from fat. Ghee contains a higher concentration of fat than butter, gram for gram, and it provides slightly more short-chain saturated fats. Overall, honestly, the differences between these two are small, and choosing one over the other likely won't significantly affect your health. However, ghee is completely free of the milk sugar, lactose, and the milk protein casein, whereas the butter contains a small amount of both of those. So some people just don't feel well when things are cooked in butter, and ghee is a great substitute, and they have no problem after eating foods made or combined with ghee. Butter and ghee are rich in saturated fatty acids, which can handle high temperatures without becoming damaged. But ghee has a higher smoke point, which is the temperature at which the fats become volatile and begins to smoke, or burn in a sense. Ghee's smoke point is 250 degrees Celsius C, which is substantially higher than butter's smoke point of 175 degrees C. Thus, when cooking at very high temperatures, ghee has a distinct advantage over butter. When I pan fry my grass-fed steak, like I said, I use ghee. I used to use butter. It would burn. It would smoke. And now I use ghee. We talk vegetable oils a lot too, so pay attention here. You see, heating ghee produces much less of the toxic compound acrylamide. When you heat vegetable oils and seed oils, you have a lot more acrylamide, and that's a bad thing. So ghee circumvents that for you as well. And before this video, I bet you thought butter and ghee were, well, unhealthy. Now you know the truth. In fact, one study found that soybean oil produced more than 10 times as much acrylamide as ghee when each was heated to 160 degrees C. When baking, however, butter is the winner here because it's sweeter and it has a creamier taste. I do know a lot of you put it into your morning coffee with your MCT oils as well. MCTs, medium chain triglycerides. That's why the creaminess of the butter really tastes good in that coffee. How many of you are doing that, by the way? Now, a couple cautions here. Those of you who have a high LDL, that's when you go into your doctor, they take your cholesterol and they look at that LDL, it's a little high, they put you on a statin. We probably should at some point talk cholesterol, statins, LDL, HDL, the whole thing, but for another day, right? But keep in mind, ghee and butter will tend to increase your LDL in response to the high saturated fat intakes. And you want to limit the ghee or butter to 1 to 2 tablespoons a day. Because of that, doctors are very quick to throw you on a statin if your LDL is up, but it's much more complex than that. One more concern with ghee is that during the production of it at high heat, its cholesterol may become oxidized. Oxidized cholesterol is linked to an increased risk of several diseases, including heart disease. Make your own ghee or buy a quality product. I know it's expensive. So how do you make it at home so it's less expensive? Well, it's easy to make. And guess what? All you really need is just one simple ingredient, and that is unsalted butter. To get started, you take out 1 pound of butter, put it into cubes, add them into a large skillet or pot, put it on low heat. Next, allow the butter to melt and bring it to a simmer. Using a slotted spoon, remove any foam or milk solids that float to the surface. They'll come to the top. You allow the ghee to cook for 15 to 20 minutes until the milk solids begin sinking to the bottom and turn that deep golden color. The ghee should also become very fragrant with a rich, kind of a nutty aroma. Once it's ready, turn off the heat. Let the ghee cool for a few minutes. Finally, you'll use a cheesecloth or even a coffee filter works. Strain the ghee into a glass container with a lid. Now, ghee can stand for 3 to 4 months at room temperature, even more. Lasts up to a year if you put it in the refrigerator. Now, to really ramp up your aesthetic nutrition, you'll want to watch this video on the top 4 supplements for your skin and a playlist down here on red light, infrareds that help reduce inflammation and build collagen in your skin. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.